ॐ सहनावतु सहनौ भुनक्तु सह वीर्यं करवावहै तेजस्विनावधीतमस्तु मा विद्विषावहै ॐ शान्ति 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 I'm very grateful to Dr. Richa for inviting me to join this important initiative at IIT Kharagpur. As we know, this program is being continued for the last, if you include this year, 3 years, and has contributed to create an awareness about the various possibilities in extending Indian knowledge system in contemporary pediatrics. This year, the focus has been on various physical science disciplines. In addition to that, we have been exposed to other domains, including Vedanta and perspective on knowledge, and also experiencing what we have from our own tradition about music. I appreciate the efforts made at IIT Kharagpur. Today, I would like to focus on what are the possibilities in extending Indian knowledge system in the domain of psychology, especially in cognitive psychology. Modern psychology is about 150 years old. During this period, it has ventured to understand a variety of issues, concerns in the domain of psychology. The development of psychology has taken place in the context of physical sciences. As a matter of fact, the model of doing science, which was very pertinent in the domain of physical sciences, was adopted by social scientists. Psychology, which grew under the impact of developments in areas of physiology as well as some areas of philosophy. Now, the growth of psychology that has taken place has adopted a stance which belongs to what we call positivism, the school of philosophy, which considers that there is an independent reality which can be objectively examined, analyzed, measured. Under the program of positivist psychology, the entire effort was to develop tools, methods to understand learning, perception, motivation, memory, and all related processes at individual level, and extending it to the level of organization and society. So, psychology has gradually diversified and the strongest association of psychology in the world is APA, American Psychological Association, and it has only 57 divisions. And all these divisions focus on different aspects of human function. They cover almost all areas of life. But the major perspective which prevails in undertaking this journey is primarily positivist in orientation. Now, the approach adopted in understanding all the psychological processes tries to make the experience, action, behavior, you take all these and you translate it into something which can be measured, which can be assessed, which can be examined. If you look at the whole effort, it tries to adopt a kind of a third-person perspective. So, some tool is given to you, let us say, a tool to measure personality, and you respond on that. The tool provides certain kinds of reports from you, and that report is quantified using some kind of numerical system that we call psychological assessment. And on that basis, we get certain scores and we then tell that your personality is like this. It's extroverted, introverted, or it has high neuroticism, and so on. So this is the strategy that has been adopted. If you go into the details, you find that it has many problems. The problems were not taken care of because it was thought that we are getting numbers, we are adopting a scientific method, and we are getting something real, objective, fact. This perspective has continued and is still continuing to a large extent. At the same time, there have been certain biases which doubted the whole effort and exercise, and different kinds of analyses were put. I'm sure you must have heard the name of Freud and Jung and many others who looked at unconscious processes. Processes which are not easily accessible, but which can be understood in terms of certain mechanisms that are postulated at a theoretical level, and they can be accessed indirectly. Now, all that has led to development of depth psychological perspectives. So, in addition to objective, observable reality, the approach provided a way to understand something which is beyond the domain of conscious behavior, and the struggle has been going on. The main emphasis for majority of psychologists has been to create a construct, then create some kind of operational definition of that. That is, the construct is made accessible in terms of certain operations, certain activities, and using that you apply some kind of scaling or rating, and then you come up with some kind of empirically derived assessment which is quantitative. And I think that has provided a way to understand one kind of reality. But definitely this reality is not a real reality in the sense that it has been reported, it has been analyzed in some way, it is mediated by some kind of instrumentation, and it is helpful in some way that you are able to relate in quantitative ways. You apply various statistical techniques to make certain generalizations, and that helps to some extent to understand reality. This strategy has been working, and many of us think that, well, it has helped a lot. But it is important to understand what kind of progress has been made. I am sharing this story because as a student of mental life psychology, I find that way back in early 20th century, attempt was made to define intelligence. And then psychologists started looking at different kinds of intelligence, you know, different factors of intelligence, one factor, two factors, several factors. Different kinds of abilities were measured. And then different ways were adopted, and at least one theory talks about 120 factors. And then a time comes in 1990 or so that people doubt idea whether there is just one kind of intelligence. And we find in Howard Gardner, a psychologist from Harvard, that it is better to understand intelligence in terms of multiple intelligence. That is, there are different kinds of intelligence. One is good in dance. So there is some kind of, you may call it bodily intelligence, or someone is a great musician, and then you have some intelligence in that area. He has talked about 9-10 kinds of it. So he comes with the theory of multiple intelligences. So the progress in knowledge in that area, where persistent efforts were made to understand, has shown that it depends on the metaphor used by the psychologist. Robert Sternberg, psychologist, has in fact written a book, Metaphors of Mind. And in that book, he proposes that all these theories depend on the kind of metaphor adopted by the researcher or a theorist. So the understanding depends on the kind of metaphor which is. I want to submit here that the theoretical development that has taken place is not cumulative in the sense that you had one area of knowledge and one area of darkness, and gradually darkness has been removed. In fact, the old questions are still there. You raise new questions. So the progress is in terms of raising new questions rather than answering old questions. Same has happened in the area of memory. You have now so many kinds of memory. If you go to personality, you find so many kinds of theories of personality. I think almost all areas, all psychological phenomena are explained in terms of diverse theories. I often bother about the kind of understanding which has taken place, the nature of understanding which has taken place, if you read the theory, it makes sense. It helps you to understand reality in certain way. But it is now difficult to give a definition of personality which is acceptable to everyone, because the nature of personality depends on the theory adopted by a theorist. So it is related to that theory. It's a mind-boggling kind of variety that has taken place in the progress of psychological knowledge. It is not cumulative. Variety has gone up, as it is reflected in 57 divisions of psychology at one level, and within each area you find so much variety. Positivism, which provided the perspective, which provided the technology, and which provided some kind of confidence that you are getting certain numbers and you are happy with that. You have scientific publications and you want to produce reliable, valid findings, and they are peer reviewed and all that has taken place. So, what Thomas Kuhn talked about paradigm, you have accepted one kind of paradigm, and which provides one kind of meta theory, which provides sanctity to one kind of methodology, and you reach to one kind of understanding, which is limited. Of course, the underlying assumption is that you want to achieve universal statements. You want to apply all kinds of theories across human world. Everywhere you want to put it like that. Here, one more important development that has taken place, perhaps in the last 50 years, and that is that psychological processes are rooted in culture. One very profound statement is that culture and psyche make each other up. One professor who looks at culture and who has done, interestingly, important work in Orissa, his name is Richard Schroeder at Chicago University, who has tried to understand morality particularly and has come up with interesting theoretical development and also understanding that. And he says that psyche and culture make each other up. So psychology can't be considered as universal in terms of its application, in terms of theorization, as it is supposed to. That limitation is very important, and it's very strange that the father of modern experimental psychology, his name is Wilhelm Wundt, who worked at Leipzig, wrote about 10 volumes of culture, and the part which he played, the role which he played in doing physiological psychology, and which later led to development of experimental psychology and psychophysics and all that, became very important, and that was imported to United States of America, everywhere. Now, the positivist science and approach which was adopted by these psychologists became the prototype to produce psychological knowledge. There is no assumption about culture. It is later realization that culture is quite important. Culture provides different categories to look at the world. And those categories allow you to understand reality under certain circumstances, describe that reality in certain ways, create different categories. So, cultural rootedness of psychological and social knowledge has been established, but many of us don't accept that. We think that if you use this kind of observation-based third-person psychological approach, then we will be able to achieve understanding which is very comprehensive and which can be applied to any group, any community, and which is global. But this kind of assertion is not appropriate, and we don't have time to elaborate this point, but there are studies from cross-cultural psychological researches. Also, some people call themselves as cultural psychologists. There are some people who think that they are using categories from a culture, and they call themselves as indigenous psychologists. So, all these efforts are telling that culture has to be taken seriously if one has to understand social reality, and there are multiple perspectives. Let me also share that the positivism is also attacked, and a lot of work is coming up which has not been received very well, even within psychology or study of cognitive processes and other various domains. But the post-positivist developments, which have taken many shapes and many forms, you know, they include largely a perspective which is constructionist. Not given, but constructed. And this construction takes place in a cultural context. So you take culture as a resource, and within that context, you create reality. Try to learn about psychological functions in cultural context. Now, this point should be made clear that culture as a man-made part of environment, that is one definition of culture, which is very interesting. Your ideas, meanings, practices constitute culture. And they inform psychology and social sciences and understanding in general. So that contribution has to be understood, and culture has to be taken into account seriously. Culture is not merely taken as one variable. Psychologists are fond of calling independent variable or merely context, but it provides content also. This is very crucial. If there is a world where there is no word like God, and if there is a word where there is a word like God, these two words are very different. Their behaviors, their practices, their understanding, their approach will be quite different, and it is there. So, these words which represent certain phenomena make things very different. Culture has to be taken seriously. That is one lesson that has come up from cultural psychological studies, cross-cultural studies, as well as from indigenous psychological studies. So, going beyond the positivist model of science and adopting post-positivist approach in doing research understanding reality as constructed provides avenues to go beyond the hegemony of one kind of perspective which has continued for a long time. Psychology as a discipline started in India in 1915 or 16 at Calcutta University. And the entire program of the studies was borrowed from the European tradition. The same kind of courses were given, and the Indian tradition of understanding or knowledge was marginalized. It's very interesting to see that you are studying various psychological phenomena without taking culture into context. And there is substantial knowledge available to us. I think this point has already been elaborated in various talks, that it is the colonization which provided a kind of context for development of new disciplines, and in social science disciplines, we are studying society, we are trying to understand various cultural phenomena with a lens which has been borrowed from Euro-American context. So that became the reference point or standard against which we are trying to study. So the practice is that you study that literature, you review that literature, and you take those theories, and you make predictions on the basis of that. I don't deny that there is similarity. There are similarities, but there are differences also, and they are also very important. Everybody who claims to be a human being has certain characteristics, certain attributes, fine, but their expression is quite varied. And the constructions are also quite varied. You find linguistic variations. You find variation in terms of religion. You find variation in so many ways. There is no point in talking about this diversity, which is present and it's evident. Now, post-positivism, going beyond the positivist tradition and the so-called scientific approach, has taken many shapes, and you have feminism, you have perspectives which are considered as critical approaches, critical paradigm is there. Now, more recently, there is an approach which is called as participatory or action-oriented paradigm to do social science research. All these paradigms provide opportunity to understand local realities, to understand how we actively participate in the creation and understanding of reality, and we also make efforts to improve the quality of life, and all that is situated in the local conditions. And all this has also recognized that it is not only the quantitative approach to understanding which is important. We need to take care of certain other methods. And those methods are qualitative in nature. Qualitative methods are available with many disciplines, like ethnography. There are other methods, grounded theory is there, phenomenological interpretive analysis is there. There are many such methods. Why I am mentioning this is that this kind of development in methodology which is broadly termed as qualitative, provides opportunity to go numbers and to appreciate reality, which is quite varied. If you go to study some problem using ethnography, you have to understand the reality as it is. And the study is not mediated by the instrument. It's the researcher who is the instrument. It requires more elaborate analysis, but I will not do that. But in qualitative methods, the construction of reality is taken very seriously. And you are open to analysis. And here I see that there is a possibility of bringing culture seriously in our efforts to understand reality. So, from positivism to post-positivism, from quantitative approaches to qualitative approaches, so the climate is changing in the Euro-American tradition also. They are more open to inquiries which use subjectivity to understand subjectivity. In fact, there is a method called autoethnography, where you analyze yourself, and that is considered as part of empirical analysis. So, in terms of methodology, the North American and European centers of psychological knowledge are going towards the use of these methods. In recent years, there has been one interesting development which is contributed by His Holiness the Dalai Lama and many people who are influenced by his work, and they include a number of cognitive psychologists, neuroscientists, and a number of publications have come. Life and Mind Institute has been created, and they are looking at the various possibilities. I will just share one interesting work, and many of you may have come across that, but it is interesting in the sense that Richard Davidson from Wisconsin has looked at how meditation contributes to mental health and various processes, and he has shown brain scans of monks who have undergone 2,000 hours of meditation, 5,000 hours of meditation. He was visiting Delhi University and he shared the data and he showed that meditation, which involves brain, contributes to change not only the reported mental condition, but there were certain organic changes. Structural changes in brain were observed. So the brain which is involved in meditation is changing itself. The structural change is taking place. Recently, Davidson has published a good volume on science of meditation, and many other activities are taking place where effects of meditation on various parameters are being looked at. There are many other developments which are taking place. For instance, Damasio, a neuroscientist, neuropsychologist, wrote in 94-95, I think, it's a wonderful book, Descartes' Error. So, his point is that we are not purely cognitive beings, and emotions are central. And in subsequent work, he has looked at how all these things take place. He's a serious neuroscientist who examines how consciousness and experience of selfhood occurs in neuropsychological terms. It's difficult reading. One idea which he says, which shares, is that there are different levels of representation in our system, biological system. So subcortical level of representations are also very important. And there is a dialogue between subcortical to cortical level changes which take place, functioning which takes place. There is another very interesting development. In the, she is a wonderful researcher in the area of emotion and neuropsychology of emotion. And one thing which she proposes is that emotion is not something which is present, but which is a contribution of brain. It's a kind of a label that you put on something which was not understood by you earlier. So the way neurosciences are moving, they are showing how brain activity, different parts of brain are engaged in the construction of reality. Friends, the developments which are taking place are indicating the role of how we actively participate in creating our own understanding, our own knowledge. I have tried to emphasize the point that culture as a resource for knowledge creation and understanding is important. And the neuroscientific approach which is emerging is also trying to bring in self processes, mental processes, central. So the third person perspective is not sufficient, which has provided for a long time a kind of knowledge which is not true knowledge. There is a serious problem with that kind of knowledge. And that provides an opportunity to create conversation between Indian perspective as well as Western perspective that we have. They are coming closer. And here, it is important to understand what are the key assumptions that the Indic system talks about. The Indian knowledge system talks about. What I am going to say might be something which is going to be repeated. I expect that many other people must have talked about that. But I think they are important in this context also. One point is that the domain of knowledge which is considered in the Indian context is one which is approached with a very different perspective. Srimad Bhagavad Gita says that jnan se pavitra is dharti par aur kuch nahi. Nahi jnanena sadrisham pavitram iha vidyate. What does it mean? There are many impurities which are removed when you get knowledge. So knowledge restructures you, reconfigures you, changes you. You are revised. You are a different person. ज्ञान जो है वो संस्कार करता है, और संस्कार का मतलब होता है यू गेट सर्टेन न्यू क्वालिटीज एंड इम्प्योरिटीज आर टेकन, जो दोष है उनको हटा दिया जाता है और जो गुण है वो आप में स्थापित किए जाते हैं. सो द होल एफर्ट ऑफ नॉलेज इज लाइक दिस दैट इट डज समथिंग टू यू. इट इज नॉट अंडरस्टैंडिंग सम एक्सटर्नल रियलिटी बट इट टच इट एम्फसाइजेस अंडरस्टैंडिंग ऑफ सेल्फ इन अ वेरी सीरियस मैनर. आत्मानं बुद्धि, अपने आप को जानो, ये क्वेश्चन अगर उपनिषद में महत्वपूर्ण है, अपने आप को जानना जरूरी है, तो अपने आप को जो कहा जा रहा है, जो आत्म का विचार है, वो अपने आप में बहुत बड़ा विचार है. मैं सोच रहा था कि व्हाट काइंड ऑफ कॉन्सेप्ट्स वी हैव एट आवर डिस्पोजल, एंड देयर इज वन सिमिलैरिटी अक्रॉस ऑल द कॉन्सेप्ट्स लाइक रस, नाट्यशास्त्र, योग, योग शास्त्र. इफ यू लुक एट दैट, और इफ यू टेक धर्म फ्रॉम धर्म शास्त्र, सो लेट अस टेक दीज थ्री टर्म्स, धर्म, योग एंड रस. व्हेन आई एनालाइज दीज आई फाइंड दैट देयर इज वन पिकुलियर सिमिलैरिटी दैट ऑल ऑफ देम talk about certain emergent qualities. Three things put together don't, the sum of three things is not equal to, you know, the emergent reality. A triangle is more than sum of three lines. New quality is put. The idea for us also says that you have sthayi bhav, Sanchari Bhav, Vibhav, Anubhav, and all of them put together. Vibhava, Anubhava, Sanchari, Sanyogat, Rasa Nishpatti. So, Ras ka emerge karna, usme kuch aur atirikta aa jata. Some extra comes when Ras exists or emerges. It is not equal to विभाव, अनुभाव एंड संचारी भाव. उनको मिला दीजिए तो ये नहीं पैदा हो, केवल बराबर. इट इज नॉट सम टोटल ऑफ दैट, इट गोज बियॉन्ड दैट इंडिविजुअल एलिमेंट. तो कहीं न कहीं अतिक्रमण करना अपने आप का. यू हैव टू ट्रांसेंड दी यू नो एग्जिस्टिंग अवेयरनेस. इट कैन बी in a broad way, you have to go beyond your ego. You have to go beyond your body. If you take the whole notion of yoga, yoga is total. Yoga is relating. Yoga ka matlab hai judna. Judne ka matlab hai ki you are incomplete. When you are doing yoga, to aap apne ko vistrit karte hai. Tab aap purun ho. So, समग्र होते हैं, टोटल होते हैं, कंप्लीट होते हैं, और या दूसरे शब्दों में कह लें आप होल होते हैं. होल, होली, हेल, हेल्दी, ये सब एक ही ग्रीक रूप से बने हैं. इंटरेस्टिंग. तो कहीं न कहीं समग्र की ओर, टोटैलिटी की ओर, और अपनी कमी को पार करके किसी ऊंची स्थिति की ओर जाना, शरीर से आत्मा की ओर, चाहे योग के आधार पर जब आप अपने समस्त अस्तित्व को देखते हैं, टोटल एग्जिस्टेंस को देखते हैं, तो आप विराट अस्तित्व की ओर. रस में भी यही है, योग में भी यही है, और धर्म का जो विचार है वो भी यही कहता है. यू हैव टू टेक इन टू अकाउंट एवरीथिंग. धर्म इज वन विच मेंटेन्स लाइफ. और धर्म की तरह तरह की व्याख्याएं की गई है. मनुस्मृति जो व्याख्या करती है, सब आप सब लोग परिचित होंगे उससे, नृत्य क्षमा दमोस्तेम शौच मंद्रिय निग्रह. तो ये सारी जो क्वालिटीज, 10 क्वालिटीज उसमें गिनाई गई हैं, उनको अगर आप पोल करके देखेंगे तो आप यही पाएंगे हाउ वी रिलेट टू ईच अदर. योग को अगर खोल करके देखेंगे तो यम और नियम जो है वो सोशल और स्पिरिचुअल ऑर्डर को मेंटेन करने के तरीके हैं. एंड दैट बिकम्स फाउंडेशन, दैट बिकम्स अ बेसिक एलिमेंट टू डू दैट. कभी कभी कहा जाता है कि योग में ये सारी स्टेजेस हैं यम नियम वगैरह, लेकिन उसको अष्टांग भी कहते हैं. और अष्टांग मिल करके समग्र का निर्माण करता है. हाथ और पैर आपका अलग अलग कोई अर्थ नहीं रखता है, व्हेन दे आर पार्ट ऑफ द होल बॉडी. जब ये होल फंक्शनल है तो पार्ट का कोई अर्थ है. सो देयर इज एन इंटेंस डिजायर टू ग्रो, टू गो बियॉन्ड और टू ट्रांसेंड बॉडीली इगोइस्टिक लिमिटेशंस. ऑल दीज आइडियाज टॉक अबाउट टोटैलिटी. If you look at the notion of purushartha, which talks about karma, artha, kama, moksha, so there is no denial that you should not do this or that. Dharma bhi kariye, arth, prosperity bhi aapko chahiye, aapko kaam, ichhaye bhi hai, har tarah ki ichhaye, unka bhi palan hona chahiye. Aur moksha jo hai, संसार का जो अनुभव है उसको ध्यान में रख करके इसके जो कष्ट हैं उनसे मुक्त होने का जो अनुभव है वो भी बड़ा महत्वपूर्ण. आई थिंक देयर इज रिकॉग्निशन दैट देयर आर प्रॉब्लम्स. आई थिंक द लिस्ट ऑफ प्रॉब्लम्स व्हिच इज गिवन इन योगा, द फाइव काइंड्स ऑफ क्लेशास, विद्या, अस्मिता, राग, द्वेष, अभिनिवेश, They provide a complete exhaustive list of all the stressors. I don't think there is anything left. So the approach is to understand the reality and to transcend that reality. मुझे लगता है कि भारतीय चिंतन परंपरा की जो सबसे महत्वपूर्ण यह विशेषता है वह इस समग्रता को, इस टोटैलिटी को पहचानना है. और योग शब्द तो अपने आप में ये उसका अर्थ ही यही है कि आप अधूरे हैं और आप पूरा होना चाहते हैं. योग जब होगा तो आप पूरा होंगे. सो गो थ्रू श्रीमद् भगवद गीता, वन वर्ड विच कम्स सो मेनी टाइम्स इज युक्त. युक्त मीन्स अप्रोप्रिएट. जब आप जुड़ गए तो आप युक्त हो गए, उपयुक्त भी हो गए, आप ठीक हो गए, अप्रोप्रिएट भी हो गए. And everything should be in order, that is yukta ahar vihar. Yukta ahar ho, yukta vihar ho, nidra ho. Ye sara agar yukta hoga to kaam theek chalega. Yukta is a central word and yukta means appropriate. And appropriate means it is contextually appropriate. It is very interesting that the whole effort which is recommended in Ayurveda is that of intersectionality. Your health is located not in you, not in your environment. It is at the intersection of both. This is very important. One needs to realize this. I think Ritu Satmya is one key concept in Ayurveda, which tells that your actions, your diet, your activities should be in tune with the season. This is very important. You have to perform things, you have to act in the context of things or the context in which you are living. That context is very important. It reminds me of an interesting article by A.K. Ramanujan, a well-known thinker and author and philosopher. He was at Chicago. He has written an interesting article, Is There an Indian Way of Thinking? thinking. It's an interesting piece which we should read. Is there an Indian way of thinking? And one of the points which he makes is one which is context sensitive, that something makes one meaning in one context and the same thing makes a different meaning in a different context. So the meaning depends on the context. This realization that you need to look at the context is so central that it pervades almost all areas. जब हम लोग धर्म अर्थ काम मोक्ष की बात करते हैं तो मुझे एक वर्स एक संस्कृत का एक श्लोक बड़ा अच्छा याद आता है, मजेदार भी है. अजरा मरवत प्राज्ञ विद्या मर्थं च चिंतयेत् गृहीत इव केशेषु मृत्युना धर्ममाच. मीनिंग इज दैट यू शुड थिंक that you will always remain young. Aap ajar rahenge, kabhi buddhe nahi honge. Amar rahenge, will not die. Ajara maravat, apne ko ajar aur amar mante huye. Ajara maravat pragya, those who are intelligent, they consider themselves as ajar and amar. Aur ye soch karke vidya aur arth ki chinta kar. They make efforts. All endeavors, vidya aur arth ki chinta karte hain. But the second line says, grihit iva keshesu mrityuna dharma majar. Ki maut jo hai aapke baal apne haath mein pakde hue hai, ye soch karke dharma ka acharan. So vidya and arth have to be pursued within the context of dharma. So, dharma will decide which vidya or how earth has to be procured. So, dharma ki kendrikta ek sandarbh ke roop mein humare vyavahar ke liye hai. Aur highest dharma jo kaha gaya hai, kai ke liye kaha gaya hai, ahinsa paramo dharma, achara paramo dharma, nahi satyat परो धर्म. तो सत्य हो अहिंसा हो, इन सबको अगर आप देखेंगे, यू टॉक अबाउट समथिंग विच इज कॉन्टेक्चुअल. यू नीड टू बादर अबाउट दैट. इफ यू लुक एट द योग सूत्र, तो महर्षि पतंजलि सेज दैट यम एंड नियम बोथ आर सार्वभौम धर्म. सार्वभौम व्रत. पतंजलि इतनी हिम्मत करते हैं और कहते हैं कि ये उस समय कहते हैं ये तो ग्लोबल है, अगर आप यम और नियम का सत्य हिंसा अस्तेय अपरिग्रह ब्रह्मचर्य संतोष तप स्वाध्याय इन सब का पालन करते हैं तो इनका पालन करना एक स्थान एक जात एक धर्म के नहीं बल्कि सबके लिए जरूरी. So there are certain common principles which are related to the basic biological and social functions. So the language which we have, the concepts which we have, they have global implications. These ideas which recognize the role of context, which recognize the significance of others. यह मेरा है और ये तेरा है, ये सोचना तो छोटे लोगों का है. आई एम निज परो वेति गणना लघु चेतसाम उदार चरिता नाम तु वसुधैव. दैट दिस काइंड ऑफ डिस्टिंक्शन इज प्रॉब्लमेटिक. यू नीड टू कंसीडर एवरीवन एज पार्ट ऑफ फैमिली. वैदिक हाइमंस ऑलवेज टॉक अबाउट संगच्छद्वं संबद्धद्वं संभो मनांसि जानता. इफ यू लुक एट दिस होल ट्रेडिशन यू फाइंड दैट देयर इज एन इंटेंस डिजायर to grow beyond the limited sense of self, limited bodily sense of self. Annamaya kosh jo hai wahi pura nahi hai, upar uthe hai, vijnanamaya kosh bhi hai, manomaya kosh bhi hai, phir aap anandamaya kosh tak aa sakte. So it is a multi-layered hierarchical structure that you have. Your existence is not merely bodily existence. It can't be understood as that. So, extending the boundary, I think there's the intense desire in learning, in relating, in working. You need to bother about the context, and you have to bother about your physical being, and you have to go beyond. शरीर माध्यम खलु धर्म साधन, शरीर जो है वह धर्म का साधन है, तो इस शरीर का उपयोग करना है. क्षेत्र क्षेत्रज्ञ योग, आप गीता में पढ़ेंगे तो आप पाएंगे कि क्षेत्र जो है या शरीर को क्षेत्र कहा गया है. यू हैव टू वर्क वेल. इनफैक्ट योग वासिष्ठ टॉक्स अबाउट ए वेरी interesting notion. The notion is of jivan mukta. It's not the liberation which comes after death. Mar karke aur moksha aapko mil gaya, swarg mein seat mil gayi, I think it's ridiculous. One has to live like a liberated being. That is the ideal. Jivan mukta. Aisa vyakti jo ki mukt ho karke jiye. मुक्त हो करके जीना. मुक्त हो करके जीने का मतलब हुआ कि यू आर नॉट बाथर्ड अबाउट वेरियस अटैचमेंट्स. यू वर्क, यू कनेक्ट विद थिंग्स एंड देन यू फॉरगेट. यू आर नॉट बाथर्ड अबाउट दैट. योग वासिष्ठ सेज दैट जीवन मुक्त पर्सन इज वन हु इज महाभोक्ता, हु इज महाकर्ता. काम चोर नहीं है, काम भी करता है, सब कुछ करता है, शरीर को भी धारण करता है, शरीर के लिए जो अपेक्षित है वह भी उसको देता है. बट द डिफरेंस बिटवीन हिम एंड वन हु इज नॉट मुक्ता इज जस्ट वन, दैट वन हैज अटैचमेंट एंड द अदर हैज नो अटैचमेंट. आई थिंक दिस इज एन इम्पॉर्टेंट पॉइंट व्हिच वी लुक्ड एट वेरी सीरियसली. भारतवर्ष आगे बढ़ रहा है और हम लोग भारतवर्ष के 75 वर्ष के स्वतंत्रता के स्मरण के साथ ये आयोजन भी कर रहे हैं. आजादी 75वां वर्ष हम मना रहे हैं एंड वी आर लुकिंग फॉरवर्ड टू हैव एन इंडिया विच इज आत्मनिर्भर, विच विल बी आत्मनिर्भर. और उसमें ज्ञान में भी आत्मनिर्भर होना चाहिए. और ज्ञान की दृष्टि से हम विश्व को क्या दे सकते हैं, इस पर भी चिंतन करने की आवश्यकता है. एंड आई थिंक दिस काइंड ऑफ इनिशिएटिव इज गोइंग टू कंट्रीब्यूट अ लॉट. देयर आर वेरियस आइडियाज. आई थिंक देयर इज ट्रेमेंडस सोर्स फॉर इंस्पिरेशन एंड मोटिवेशन अवेलेबल इन ऑलमोस्ट ऑल डिसिप्लिन. ह्यूमन अफेयर्स आर वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट. And I think that there are many avenues in which pursuing work will be very healthy and helpful. When we talk about cognitive science and psychology and understanding notions of knowledge, there is a lot of available research and ideas and thoughts which contribute to our understanding. I initially talked about positivism and post-positivism and the view that knowledge is culturally conditioned and you need to think about it. One profound area where connectivity is possible. Indian thinking has a number of interesting notions. I will just mention one about Indian epistemology, which talked about not only pratyaksha, that is empirical, it is accepted, but iske saath hi aur bhi hai, anumaan bhi hai. उपमान भी है, शब्द प्रमाण भी है, यहाँ तक कि अभाव को भी एक माध्यम ज्ञान का माना गया है। और इसके साथ ही साथ यह भी है ऐतिहासिकता, हिस्टोरिसिटी, इसको भी माना गया है। ऑल स्कूल्स ऑफ थॉट डोंट कंसीडर ऑल ऑफ देम, सम एग्री टू यूज सम एंड सम डोंट एग्री। और सबसे बड़ी बात जो भारतीय ज्ञान के बारे में है, भारतीय चिंतन के बारे में है, कि इट रेस्पेक्ट्स डाइवर्सिटी। यहाँ पर वेदांत भी है, मीमांसा भी है, न्याय भी है, जैन भी है, बौद्ध भी है, आस्तिक विचार भी है और नास्तिक विचार भी है। केवल वेदांत को ही आप लें तो वेदांत में ही यू हैव अद्वैत वेदांत, विशिष्टाद्वैत, द्वैताद्वैत, यू हैव एटलीस्ट 4-5 काइंड्स ऑफ यू नो थॉट्स अबाउट वेदांत। सो इट्स वेरी रिच ट्रेडिशन, और उसमें बहुत सारी हाइपोथेसिस हैं, बहुत सारी थियोरीज हैं। दुर्भाग्य है कि हम लोग उससे परिचित नहीं, इस तरह का जो प्रयास हो रहा है वह उससे परिचित कराने का काम कर रहा है। इट्स यू नो दी होल, इट्स ए इनसाइक्लोपीडिक यू नो नॉलेज जो कि किसी भी एरिया में आप पाएंगे। वी आर प्राउड ऑफ दैट, लेकिन केवल कहने से तो नहीं होगा, उसको ज्ञान में हम उपयोग कैसे ले हैं। इम्पिरिकल के नाम पर आई एम सॉरी टू से दैट अ लॉट ऑफ यूजलेस वर्क टेक्स प्लेस। यू कैन कनेक्ट एनीथिंग विद एनीथिंग, कोई उसमें नियम कानून कुछ नहीं है। इन सोशल साइंसेस पीपल टेक एनी नोशन एंड दे रिलेट टू एनी अदर नोशन एंड दे फाइंड कोरिलेशंस एंड डू सो। इन टर्म्स ऑफ रिसर्च देयर इज proliferation of lot of activity, and but then you are imitating Western theories and you aid more and more. So उन Western theories से जो हम research करते हैं वो न हमारे काम का होता है और न उनके काम का होता है, जिनके वो सिद्धांत हैं। ये सारी समस्याएं हैं। ये जरूर है कि उनके जर्नल्स में कुछ पेपर्स हमारे अच्छे छप जाते हैं और अच्छा भी लगता है, लेकिन क्या ज्ञान में कोई वृद्धि हो रही है या नहीं, ये एक विचारणीय प्रश्न है। ज्ञान की दृष्टि से अगर हम कोई परिवर्तन ले आना चाहते हैं तो कहीं ना कहीं हमारे दृष्टि में परिवर्तन ले आना पड़ेगा। आई विल कंक्लूड बाई ड्राइंग टू drive your attention to one very interesting thing, which is very important for our work, for our research, for our life. I just mentioned that the difference between Jivan Mukta, a person who is living life like a liberated being, and a person who is not liberated. दोनों में फर्क ये है कि एक में attachment है, दूसरे में attachment नहीं। Attachment is a key issue. And I think Srimad Bhagavad Gita is one very important source which deliberates on this issue and emphasizes that you need to work without attachment. Is it possible to work without attachment? And then if it is possible, then how it can be attained? I think it's a very interesting question. And at the same time, Bhagavad Gita is considered to be Yoga Shastra. And Shri Krishna is called as Yogishwar. Yog, jaisa maine kaha ki yog ka matlab hai judna. Aap sab iska anubhav karte honge, ya shabd jo hai, isi ke liye prayog mein hota hai. Yuj dhatu se banta hai, iska matlab hi hai judna. To, ye judna, और अनासक्त कहने का मतलब है कि आप मत जुड़ो, और कहते हैं कि अनासक्त का योग भी होना चाहिए, अनासक्त योग। हाउ इट आई मीन अनासक्त का मतलब है कि जुड़ो न जुड़ो, सॉरी अनासक्त मतलब न जुड़ो, नॉन अटैचमेंट, और योग का मतलब है अटैचमेंट। इन दोनों के बीच में क्या रिश्ता हो सकता है? It is very interesting. I soch raha tha, and then I thought that perhaps if you analyze the whole stuff, jo ideas hain, jo examples hain, jo kuch hain, there are two important insights which need to be elaborated. I'm not very clear, but I just wanted to share with you, and you may think about it, that Bhagavad Gita talks about a state of being which is called sthita pragya, steady wisdom. Now, it's a great state where harsh, khushi, और जब हर्ष नहीं है विषाद है, जब अच्छा होता है और जब बुरा होता है, दोनों में यू आर नॉट इन्फ्लुएंस्ड बाय दैट. बोथ आर पीसेज ऑफ इंफॉर्मेशन. दे रिड्यूस अनसर्टेनिटी, दे आर पीसेज ऑफ इंफॉर्मेशन. डोंट टेक मोर देन दैट. और स्थित प्रज्ञ का मतलब ही यही है कि जो स्टडी विजडम है, नॉट इन्फ्लुएंस्ड बाय अदर थिंग्स. तो योग की अगर साधना है, अगर आप लिबरेटेड बीइंग बनने की दिशा में आगे बढ़ रहे हैं, अभ्यास और योग दो तरीके बताए, अभ्यास और विरक्ति, ये दो तरीके बताए, तो माइंड जो है, हमारा मन जो है वो नियंत्रण में रहेगा. तो फिर हम जो चाहेंगे वैसा होगा. इफ योर माइंड इज नॉट कंट्रोल under your control, then things will be disrupted. अनासक्त अगर रहते हैं तो माइंड का कंट्रोल संभव है. जहां आसक्त हुए वहां पर माइंड का कंट्रोल नहीं हो पाएगा. दिस मेंटल रेगुलेशन विच इज टॉक्ड अबाउट, स्थित प्रज्ञ की स्थिति होगी तभी जब आप अनासक्त हो सकते हैं. अनासक्त होने का मतलब क्या है? What is the meaning of? एक सीधा मतलब जो मेरी समझ में आ रहा है वो ये है कि द टास्क विच इज एट योर डिस्पोजल इटसेल्फ इज योर गोल, इटसेल्फ इज योर प्रोसेस. देयर बोथ कोएग्जिस्ट. इट्स नॉट द आउटकम विच इज वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट. ये जो हम शॉर्टकट अपने मन में बना लेते हैं, वी आर मोर इंटरेस्टेड इन द आउटकम रादर देन द प्रोसेस, रादर देन द एक्ट, रादर देन द बिहेवियर ऑफ एक्शन. If we bring that outcome within the process itself, in the act itself, if acts become enjoyable, if learning becomes enjoyable, then there is no need to bother about the outcome of that. Agar aapko padhna, sunna, bolna, khelna, sangeet aap sunte hain, sangeet jab sunte rehte hain, then you are enjoying. म्यूजिक बढ़िया आप सुनते हैं, राग अनुराग सुनते हैं, तो आप उसको एंजॉय करते हैं, उसका अनुभव करते हैं. तो एंजॉयमेंट उसके अनुभव उस प्रोसेस में ही मौजूद है. इफ यू एक्सटेंड दिस टू अनासक्ति इन टर्म्स ऑफ योर एक्शंस, अगर हम कर्म करने में, उस पढ़ने में प्रॉब्लम जो हम सॉल्व कर रहे हैं, उस प्रक्रिया में अगर हम अपना ध्यान रखते हैं, देन योगा कर्मसु कौशलम, कर्म में कुशलता तभी आती है. देयर इज नो नीड टू थिंक अबाउट ए सेपरेट आउटकम. आउटकम इज प्रेजेंट इन द एक्ट इटसेल्फ. आई थिंक दिस थिंकिंग ऑफ सेपरेटिंग द टू हैज क्रिएटेड. If we emphasize, if we give more emphasis on action itself, make action as enjoyable, make learning as enjoyable, then perhaps we will be able to achieve quality in our performance, in our relationships, in our life. Then we can live life which is life of a jivan mukta. I think Indian wisdom, Indian thought has this quality that it tries to transcend the limits, and it also tries to solve the problems by this approach. जहां पर आप लिमिटेड सोचते हैं वो मुश्किल खड़ी। यू नीड टू बी ब्रॉड माइंडेड। अगर ये विस्तृत हमारा दृष्टिकोण हो तो शायद एक अच्छे मनुष्य के रूप में, अच्छे विद्यार्थी के रूप में, अच्छे अध्यापक के रूप में हम कार्य कर सकते हैं। जो हमारी क्वालिटी ऑफ लाइफ है, क्वालिटी ऑफ वर्क है, वो सब अधिक अच्छा होगा यदि हम इस दृष्टिकोण को अपनाते हैं कि वी आर नॉट मियर दिस बॉडी, वी आर मोर देन दिस बॉडी। इफ यू आर एबल टू ट्रांसेंड दिस, इफ वी थिंक इन टर्म्स ऑफ ट्रांसफॉर्म आवर थॉट्स अबाउट आवर लाइफ, बिकॉज ऑल दिस इज कंस्ट्रक्टेड। पर स्वामी विवेकानंद कहते हैं आत्मनः मोक्षार्थम जगत हिताय, ये दोनों लक्ष्य हमारे होने चाहिए। तो शायद ये भारतीय चिंतन का ये दृष्टिकोण है जो कि हमारे अपने हित के लिए भी और सबके हित के लिए अवसर प्रदान करता है। मैं इन शब्दों के साथ आपको एक बार पुनः बधाई देता हूँ और मेरी आशा है कि आप जरूर विभिन्न सूत्रों को लेकर के जिन विषयों में आप कार्य कर रहे हैं वहां पर यह देखेंगे कि वह हमारे लिए कितना प्रासंगिक हो सकता है और इन विचारों की क्या उपयोगिता। बहुत बहुत।